We're calling the meeting of the Board of Public Works to order on February 24, 2022. I think, would the director please call the roll?
I think, am I going to call the roll? Okay.
But Diana usually does, but she's not here.
Yes, no, I will do that. So Commissioner Moriarty is not here at the moment. Commissioner Shoneman?
Here.
Here.
Commissioner Shea?
Here.
Mayor Donches?
Here, so we have a quorum.
And
of course, we have Alderman Mike O'Brien, who is the representative of the Board of Aldermen. The first motion is to, is item A regarding the agenda. Commissioner Shoneman?
I move to approve the agenda as presented.
Any discussion? Ask Mr. Conant, he's here, to come up and introduce himself to you, the new Park Works guy.
I do have a question, I'm sorry.
Yes.
The packet I received had a difference in the engineering.
Yes.
That's different than what we're given.
Yeah.
That item, well, all of engineering is kind of different now, right? Correct.
Engineering is different?
The sewer project was, mine has motion E under engineering as a sewer replacement project award.
Now, which item by letter are you talking about?
Item E, under engineering department. I had award of the construction contract for 2022 sewer replacement project that I received maybe Friday. But that's not in.
It's not, okay.
It's not in this one.
So let's go by that, I'm surprised that's in your packet, so. Let's go by the goldenrod, so that will be a change from what was posted. That will be in, that was actually pulled because the city engineer did a little more research, so that will be coming to our next meeting.
Okay.
So that will not be
so
coming before
you.
So that
is a difference. We don't need to do anything about it.
Correct.
Okay.
We're just not going to take it up tonight.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry, I didn't realize that was in your packet.
I was a little confused.
So we are going by what's on the gold.
There are two changes, though, on the goldenrod that I will bring to your attention. One is, and they're both wastewater, one is in motion C. In your packet, you had, in the original packet, it had $345,500. It'd been $339,000.
Oh, okay.
Or it was the other, it should have been $339,000, $500,000, yes.
It's already in there.
Yeah, okay. I don't have the goldenrod copy. That's why I wanted to. And then the second one is on motion D. This is just a small one. But it says, where it says to approve change order one to the pump station upgrades on phase one, that should have been phase two, not phase one.
It is.
Oh, okay.
And it is on the goldenrod, but not on your original packet. Yes.
Understood. Okay.
Those are the only two changes. So if you follow the goldenrod, you'll have all the corrected information.
This agenda as presented.
As presented, yes. The goldenrod copy is presented.
All right, so the motion by Commissioner Shoneman is to approve the agenda with the goldenrod being the one. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. And we should recognize that Commissioner Moriarty is present for the meeting.
Thank you. Thank you.
We next have public comment. Is there any member of the public who would like to address the Board of Public Works? Please, ma'am, come up to the microphone here and give your name and address, and there is a 3-minute time.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. My name is Mary Teresa Freund. I live at 3 Macefield Road in Nashua. When I first moved to Nashua in 2007, I was impressed with the city's efforts in recycling. Today, the Four Hills landfill separates many different categories of recyclable materials and even has a yard waste composting program. Sorry. I'm here today to follow up on a suggestion I sent to the commissioners in an email last week. This is a request that you now seriously consider adding composting of food waste to these municipal efforts. News, food waste accounts for 8% of greenhouse gas emissions. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency reports that uneaten food is the single biggest component of municipal solid waste, averaging one-fifth of municipal solid waste. A 2013 MIT study found that a tool for municipalities to pursue a variety of environmental goals, from zero waste to greenhouse gas emissions reduction. In addition, composting can save cities money on tipping fees by diverting waste from the landfills. And composting can enhance public health by returning vital nutrients, reducing groundwater contamination, and keeping pests out of the landfill. Sorry, I'm out of breath from walking up those steps. Since then, private and municipal composting has become much more widespread. Most recently, beginning on January 1st, 2022, every jurisdiction in California solid waste collection services is required to provide organic waste collection service to all residents and businesses. All California residents are also required to separate organic waste from other trash. Our neighbors in the Vermont legislature unanimously passed the Universal Recycling Law, Act 148, which includes banning food scraps from the landfill. Since July 1st, 2020, residents are prohibited from including food scraps in their trash. Cities such as Seattle, San Francisco, and Portland, Oregon have established mandatory separation of food scraps as part of their residential sanitation pickup. MIT study, even New York City launched a curbside organics collection program. Closer to home, Portsmouth, New Hampshire has municipal composting, but no household pickup. Citizens voluntarily bring garbage to a central drop-off point. That could be a starting point for Nashua as we gear up for a curb. However, the goal should be a third waste bin with scheduled home pickups. You are familiar with the private household composting in Nashua operated by Grow Nashua, which has weekly food scrap pickups. Having no public access to such composting services is really an equity issue, available only to those who can afford. I know that the city has made some minimal efforts to encourage home composting, for example, by selling low-cost composting bins. But again, these are not ongoing programs. Not everyone knows about them, and some people simply cannot afford them. Furthermore, backyard composting requires more knowledge and commitment.
I apologize, but we do ask that you keep to 3 minutes, which is pretty much up at this point.
I've just got a little bit more, is that okay?
All right, just finish.
Okay, let me see. Not all residents have, I'm speeding it up. Not all residents have yards. Apartment dwellers might wish to participate, might have not have the strength or balance or agility. Again, equity issue. Starting and promoting a citywide composting problem will incur financial costs, paperwork, and unforeseen glitches, but it'll be worth it. Unlike plastic, which probably costs the city money to recycle, composting could be at least self-supporting. It could be used by the parks and city residents. I guess I can end there, but just in summary, composting would save us money by diverting food waste from the landfill, promote human health and planet health, and reduce landfill pests. Okay, please don't wait until we're forced to deal with the consequences of not dealing with it.
All right, thank you very much. All right. Now, we'd like Mr. Conant to come up and just introduce himself. This is the new Park Rec Director.
Mr. Mayor, I put my hand up. Mr. Mayor?
Go ahead.
Mr. Mayor?
Alderman Jenny.
Oh, Alderman.
I had my hand up, but I guess you didn't see it.
I did not. I didn't even know we had Zoom for this, so thank you. Yes, do you have public comment?
I do. I wanted to, I'm the alternate liaison to the Board of Public Works, but I didn't know whether Alderman O'Brien would be there today, but I see he's there, and he usually is. But I wanted public comment on behalf of the members of Ward 5. From the time I first ran for Ward Alderman, I've received a lot of complaints that I've conveyed over to you and the police department and the director about West Hollis Street. And the director has been very good about the responding to those complaints, but she has pointed out that we really need a corridor study of West Hollis Street. The last time, a few meetings ago, some of my constituents appeared before you and complained about, you've got a lot of complaints from people who live along West Hollis Street itself, having trouble getting out of their driveways onto West Hollis Street, and people on the side streets having trouble, getting onto West Hollis Street. And the traffic has increased because of the additional development that has occurred. And now we have the new Public Works building being constructed at the landfill. And about the corridor study. And so I just wanted to take this opportunity with the budget coming up and the Capital Improvements Committee starting to meet. I wanted to bring your attention to this. You, Mr. Mayor, and Director Foto have both said that a study is needed. And so I wanted to bring your attention to it, move that up on the capital improvements list, and hopefully put it into the budget for next year, so that capital corridor study, not the capital corridor, but the corridor West Hollis Street study occur, so that we can try to figure out how we can deal with the increased traffic along that road.
All right, thank you very much. All right, any other members of the public? If not, let's have Mr. Conant introduce himself, tell us a little bit about himself, and maybe tell us how his first two weeks
have been great. It's good to see you. Meet you. Brian Conant. Very excited to be the city superintendent of Parks and Recreation. Went to UMass Amherst. Graduated with my bachelor's of science in plant, soil, insect science. Have an associate's degree in turf grass management. And hopefully I'm an asset for the city for a long time. Any questions or?
Your thoughts for Mr. Conant?
What's your favorite park so far?
What's my favorite park so far? Well,
you can change it later after you've been here for a while.
You promise you're not going to hold me to this? I would have to say mine's false. Okay. So far.
Good choice.
All right.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr.
All right. We now have a motion regarding the minutes of the last meeting. Commissioner Lemon.
Motion to approve the minutes of the Board of Public Works meeting of January 20th, 2022.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion passes. I guess we should have done this before public comment, but we did not. solid waste, item A, Commissioner Shea.
The motion is to approve change order number one to the engineering services contract for the city of Nashua's landfill with Sanborn Head and Associates of Concord, New Hampshire, in the amount of $66,000. Funding will be through Department 168 Solid Waste, Fund Solid Waste, Account 53 Professional and Technical Services.
All right, Mr. LaFleur.
Jeff LaFleur, Superintendent of Solid Waste. As you know, or maybe you don't know, Sanborn Head's our engineer for our landfill. They do a lot of engineering. They know everything about our landfill. They've done a lot of research. They've been part of our engineering services for the better part of 11 years, 12 years now. Last year, we went out to bid. We went out for a three-year contract for them to do our general engineering. They gave us a quote of $90,000 a year to do our Title V permits, our normal every year permitting and questionnaires for the DES. This year, we actually had some anomalies that happened to the landfill. We had to do some extra testing from DES. We have a leachate management system that we had to do some engineering and working on and do some extra piping to make sure that we're not, you know, hurting the environment. So they did a lot of work on that for us. They did a lot of work on doing some added questions, added testing for PFAS and stuff like that. So this is an accumulation of events that happened weren't expected as part of our general engineering. Typically, I would get quotes for them to do these extra projects, but where DES gave us such a time constraint to do these projects, I had them bill it against our general engineering services contract. That's where this is coming in, these extra charges to do all this stuff. It's a timely matter when we deal with DES. They want the answers right away and do all the approvals, go to finance, do this, do that. It takes a long time, as you guys know. So I had the open contract. I did the work right away. Now I'm coming for a change order to complete the final stages of the engineering for the season.
Discussion, questions? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion passes.
Thank you.
On to the street department. Item A, Commissioner Moriarty.
Move to approve change order number one to the contracts with Eastern Mineral and Granite State Mineral for a net change in an amount not to exceed $75,000. Funding will be through Department 161 Streets, Fund General, Account Classification 16 Materials.
Mr. Ibarra.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. John Ibarra, Street Superintendent. Every year we budget $465,000 for salt. Last year, the salt jumped from $49.50 a ton to $72 a ton. So we're pulling in about 3,000 ton less this year for that same budgeted amount. The ice we've had this year, we've burned through quite a bit of salt, and I'm hoping that this change order will get us through the season. Hopefully I don't have to stand back before you looking for more money later. But hard to predict what Mother Nature will throw at us, but this will bring me about another 700 ton into the equation. And I'm happy to answer any questions.
Anyone? Commissioner Shoneman.
It has been a wild winter. Maybe not as bad as 2015, I heard. I didn't live here at that time, but I heard it was quite interesting. And we're apparently not done yet. So what I read was that we're almost out of salt. Is that the case?
As of today, I had 50,000 left in that budget.
The actual product?
Out of the, oh no, I have about a half a barn full.
Half a barn full,
yep.
Okay. But I was going to bring this up at Commissioner comments. Maybe this is the appropriate time, but considering that it's been such a wild winter, it would be, I think, fruitful to see where we are in our snow removal budget.
Mm-hmm.
We have a very for snow removal, but it's been quite a winter, so I think it would be good for us to look at where we are and not wait. So if that would be possible, I think that would be really good.
For the next meeting, to bring in an update,
yeah.
Is that what you're thinking?
Maybe in the future, this time of year, January, February, would be a good time to regularly get a report on where we're getting close to budget for snow removal as a whole, not just the salt and the plowing, but the salaries for the overtime and all the things that go into snow removal. It would be good to see where we are.
Sure.
So we can kind of give just a sort of an overall. I don't have the numbers, unfortunately. I wish I had the numbers in front of me, but I don't. But we're trending pretty much where we normally are for this time of year.
Okay.
We've had a lot of ice this year, more than usual, so that has required us to use more salt. So the combination of that and the price increase is why we're asking for, but we're not hitting the trust fund at this point. This is coming out of contractor services because we haven't used as many contractors, so we are still within our snow budget. And I don't anticipate, and Superintendent, you can add if you want, but I don't anticipate that we'll should never have said that because now we're going
to. Yeah, thanks a
but
lot.
I know,
thanks.
Now we're going to get right. We're going to put in a bunch of horrible snowstorms, right? But we're trending where we should be for this time. But I can bring the actual numbers in next meeting.
That would be excellent.
You can look at.
Thank you.
Sure. Absolutely.
All right. So we'll take that up at the next meeting. But we still have the motion. Any other discussion? Questions? Say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you.
Motion passes. We have wastewater. Mr. Boucher. Item A, Commissioner Shoneman.
I move to approve the user warrants as presented.
Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion passes. Item B, Commissioner Lemon.
To approve the energy recovery generator 3-year maintenance contract with Southworth Milton Incorporated, Milton CAT, of Milford, Mass., in an amount not to exceed $277,014. Funding will be through Department 169 Wastewater Fund, Wastewater Account Classification, Property Services.
Mr. Boucher.
Thank you. Dave Boucher, Wastewater Superintendent. So the wastewater facility had an upgrade to its energy recovery building, which included the installation of 2 brand new CAT generators. These generators run off the biogas that's produced by our digester process. Southworth Milton CAT, they are the authorized and service reps for the CAT generator. So we want to go with this company. Some of the benefits are is their approach to maintaining these generators, because the biogas can be a dirty gas, it takes more maintenance than a regular generator. This company is coming in, they're doing more oil samplings, more oil changes, so that we understand what the baseline, how often it needs to be done. Within the also replacement parts to the top end of the generators, with the difficulties of getting parts in a timely fashion, if generators break down and all that, Southworth Milton CAT has parts readily available to them. We can get them sooner than later. So we'd like to go with this company to service the equipment.
Anyone?
Do you know offhand what the cost of this contract is as compared to the previous iteration? Is this a new contract or is this is a renewal, right?
No, this is a replacement of an existing generator. Unfortunately, I started 4 years ago. That generator hadn't been working, so I don't know how that got serviced. So this is a new contract, new generators, so I have nothing to compare it to.
Okay, thank you.
All those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion passes. We now have item C, Commissioner Shea.
The motion is to approve the award of the primary and secondary digester coating project to John W. Egan Company Incorporated of West Newton, Massachusetts, in the amount of $339,000. Funding will be through Department 169 Wastewater Fund Wastewater Activity Digester Gas Tank Coating.
Dave Boucher, Wastewater Superintendent. So this project includes, we have two tanks. One is a 1.3 million gallon sludge holding tank. The other one's a 500,000 gallon holding tank. Both steel, but the 1.3 million special insulation and a rubberized coating. So this project doesn't just include a resurfacing, recoating. There's some repairs to the rubber membrane that has to be done to the digester. So this company we've dealt with before on other projects, so they're capable of recoating these tanks, which are due for painting. We did we had another tank in this area that was done last year, so upkeep.
Anyone? Questions, comments? All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Next, we have item E, Commissioner item D, Commissioner Moriarty.
I would move to approve change order number one to the Public Upgrades Phase Two contract with DeFelice Corporation of Draken, Massachusetts, in an amount not to exceed $139,313.15 for additional work at several pump stations. Funding will be through Department 169 Wastewater Fund SRF loan. Pump Station Upgrades Phase Two.
Go ahead.
So this project involves upgrading seven pump stations and one CSO site. Some of the costs associated with this change order, we have increased costs in the purchase of the new generators that are going to go at some of these sites. One of the buildings had to be relocated. It's a brand new building, so it hasn't been built yet. We have changes in piping configurations. It had to be done because the pumps that are coming with the building wouldn't work with the location and where it sits next to the wet well, the existing wet well, so that had to be reconfigured. Another area at Santier Pump Station, that one, the sewer line has to be redirected so it comes into our different angle, so modifications has to be done inside the tank. And there's some other items in here for to assist us with maintenance, routine maintenance, and the ease of it by putting in some clean outs.
Questions, comments? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. E, Commissioner Shoneman.
I move to approve the contract with Wright Pierce to provide a Class A upgrade evaluation preliminary design plan and specifications in an amount not to exceed $199,886.60. Funding for this contract will be through Department 169 Wastewater Fund Wastewater WW Class A Biosolids Upgrade.
Thank you, Mayor. So the wastewater facility currently has a Class B biosolids, which is a beneficially reused, and we spread it on farmlands throughout New Hampshire and some places in Massachusetts. We're starting to see changes in regulations. It may get more difficult in where we can apply it. By moving to a Class A, which is additional heating to the biosolids that we have, loosens up some of the regulations as to where we can put it. Plus it makes it lighter, it reduces the volume of it. So in the end, it will reduce trucking costs, which we're starting to see increase fuel costs. Also give us more opportunities of, you know, applying it not just on farmlands, but other places as well. So this is to hire Wright Pierce to do the preliminary study for that, going into that Class A biosolids, which will bring us up to specifications, you know, going into a bid.
Anybody? Commissioner Shea.
I imagine this is something that we sell, is that correct?
Currently, it's a product that we have shipped out. We have an agreement with RMI, and they take it. They spread it on farmlands. They have permits and contracts at all these farmlands to distribute it. So we paid them to dispose of it for us.
Okay. I'm just wondering if the changes change the value proposition of the final product any. I know it's more usable, but just out of curiosity.
Yeah, I mean, when we go into, this is a contract with them, so that it'll open up to other, you know, bidders where they can spread it if we, you know, have to continue on the contract or put it out to bid again. So yes, they will bid based on, the value of it is, you know, being more feasible to spread it other than just farmlands, plus the weight, it'll be less, so be more cost beneficial to us getting rid of it.
Thank
we
you.
Have to put it somewhere. It's unfortunate we generate it every day. Somewhere.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Commissioner Moriarty.
I would just make comment that adding the last four motions is basically $1 million we're spending here this month, and it just goes to show just how expensive it is to upkeep the wastewater treatment facility. It's very expensive. So.
Commissioner Shonam.
So if I understand right, this is a contract to do an evaluation of what you plan to do now. Is that correct?
Correct. There's different methods to making a Class A biosolid.
Okay. And
the most traditional is advanced drying, but there's a lot of different techniques for doing that. So it'll look at what's the best option for us.
So whether you feel like it's going to be better to remain Class B or to upgrade to Class A, or are you going to let them figure that out?
I'll let them figure it out. Well, I do have a prediction. I think it is more beneficial to go to a Class A, but you know, you can't jump the gun.
Can I just add something
yes.
to that, Dave? So part of our concern, too, is that Class B is to find applications for, so we are concerned that we may get to the point where we may not have any options for disposal of that material. So mm-hmm. the Class A, we could even use the Class A for cover at the landfill. So there would be to Commissioner Shea's point, there could be a significant cost savings because we wouldn't incur having to pay, you know, to find places to apply the material. So this last time, I think we only had one bidder, it's concerning that if nobody bid on it, you know, what would we do? So there are a lot more applications for the Class A sludge biosolid. So,
and do you feel like following up on that? Do you feel like the cost saving is going to balance with whatever the cost is going to further dehydrate the Class B and get up to Class A?
Over time, I just don't know what that is yet. I don't know how long this equipment lasts before you have to replace parts on it and that, so.
Okay.
A lot of facilities are going this route. I just don't think there's a lot of longevity in some of the local facilities there. They're further out. We're gonna look at some of these facilities as they come to what type of process they're using and which one's more beneficial to us.
Okay, thank you.
All right, anyone else? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now on to engineering. Item A, Commissioner Lemon.
I motion to approve the sewer service as submitted.
Anybody? Discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. Item B, Commissioner Shea.
I move to approve 8 pole license petitions as listed in the staff memo.
Any discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. We now have item C, Commissioner Moriarty.
The motion is to consider the hardship request from Penichuk Water Works to excavate in Broad Street to replace aging infrastructure in advance of planned city paving.
Mr. Hudson.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Dan Hudson, city engineer. This is Waterworks, a hardship request. They're in the process of constructing water lines, replacing copper and lead lines, and we have representatives of Penachuk here to speak in more detail to why they're doing that. But this request here is to excavate into Broad Street, which was last paved in July of 19, and then to restore the roadway. The moratorium requirements require an inlay 20 feet beyond the work. In this case, they're requesting a slight alteration, only do that for half the roadway so that we don't mill on the other side of the road where no work is proposed. So with that, Pete Tedder and Ryan Houle are here from Penachuk, and I'll turn the mic over to them for any questions.
All right.
Good evening. My name's Pete Tedder. I'm the distribution engineering manager and distribution engineer at Penachuk Water Works. We're looking for permission to dig and excavate in the moratorium street, in this case Broad Street. Our water main's located in the gutter of Broad Street, and we're actually replacing the water main on Chautauqua Ave. Chautauqua Ave has a 1 1/2 inch steel water main that was put in 1956. They generally have a 4. It's already beyond its lifespan presently, and we're concerned that if the city does their paving program over that existing street and over that existing main, it'll likely break frequently after the paving is completed on that street. In addition, there's a big push now to remove lead service pipes, lead service joints from water mains, water service. This is one of the streets where we're likely to encounter what they call lead goosenecks that allowed, there are short lengths of lead pipe that allowed alignment from the service connections to the water main. And we'd like to, you know, assure everybody that those have been removed from our water distribution system as well. So we're tackling some of these small water mains on these side streets now to eliminate, you know, the lead contamination potential. Broad Street, we're proposing to do the mill and overlay out to center line of the road. Chautauqua is very near the intersection of Broad Street and Amherst Street. It's a very busy section of road. And we felt by eliminating a seam going across to the north lane, that would be the westbound lane, we'd help eliminate a traffic problem while we're working there. And also, people have to travel over when they're traveling on Broad Street.
Discussion? Questions? Commissioner Shoneman.
I have a few questions regarding this. What are the state requirements regarding lead and copper?
Well, they want us, they've made it clear to us they want to make sure we've eliminated all. You used to run lead pipe all the way to the homes. Those have pretty much all been eliminated. It's the steel services that go to the homes, and they had that lead gooseneck, that short length of lead in there, and they want to eliminate any possibility of lead leachates into the water.
How long are you given to do this changeover and to remove?
I've gotten started on it this year. It's going to take us some time to tackle all the small water mains in town.
Do you have 2 years, 5 years, 10 years?
I would say 4 to 5 years.
4 to 5 years, okay.
For the small water mains. The larger water mains may have lead goosenecks off of them, but they'll be replaced in time. But the focus right now is to tackle where we suspect we have lead gooseneck connections.
So you suspect you won't be certain until you actually dig into the road if there are lead goosenecks.
Right. They didn't record where they used them and where they didn't. We just know the spots where they're most likely to have used them.
Okay. And this may be a question for Mr. Hudson. Why does the city usually require digging from repairing that from curb to curb?
So that's straight out of the ordinance. There is an ordinance that requires that. From our perspective, if you're on a small street and digging half the street in the middle of the street, it kind of makes sense to do the complete restoration curb to curb. But in this type of a situation where you're on one side or the other side, curb to curb milling may not make sense. Next, we are evaluating, you know, alternatives to some of these criteria that have been around for a long time. As we've done them, we've had additional thoughts, and next month I plan to bring in for a discussion a couple ideas on how we might amend some of these ordinances.
Okay, so to curb, repairing from curb to curb isn't because it's better for the road.
It is better for the road if you're near the area that you did the more extensive excavation. So the requirement is, you know, they dig a trench, they have to come back, they have to do a 3-foot cut back around all that, pave that full depth, and then this is, in addition to that, go 20 feet beyond that and mill in all directions. And I think that's to make smooth transitions, seal the surface, and all that makes sense. But when you're, you know, if you're going all the way across the road, that in some cases that's more than 20 feet away from where you were working, and to mill and create another seam in the surface pavement may not make sense in that area, given that it's not adjacent to the work. So this proposal, they're going to be working in one lane. Often there's a leaving in separate poles, so it makes sense to at least take it that far, but I can understand why they're requesting not milling the other lane where no work is proposed.
All right, I understand setting aside the traffic considerations and, you know, not wanting to dig into the other lane. Do you think that putting, you know, a patch, just a slap in the middle of one lane is going to make it worse for the life of the road or better?
I think that in this case we're not going to introduce a seam where one isn't necessary. So in this case I think it's probably better to not carry the mill and overlay across the whole roadway. Just carry it to the center line where there was a seam. You know, this patch is still an extensive patch. It's the trench, it's 3-foot cutbacks, and it's like it's a small patch, but it's just focusing in the repair in the area where the damage was done.
Okay. I will say that this is a young road, and it really isn't in the best interests of the taxpayers who are paying for this large project and the people who live on the road to this. There's 2 years still available to do this rehabilitation of the water lines to take out the lead. So I'm not in favor of this. Thank you.
How, can I just had a couple questions for Penichuk.
But does anybody have anything for Mr. Hudson?
Yes.
Commissioner Moriarty.
Is the plan paving for that street, Chautauqua?
It's already been deferred pending Penichuk's work, because just as Penichuk doesn't want us to pave a street and then have problems after, we don't want that either. So we've delayed paving of Chautauqua until such time as Penichuk does their work, because we know it's forthcoming. In this case, you know, that abuts into Broad Street, which we encroach into Broad Street. So that's the unfortunate piece. But both this item and the next item are roads that were intended to be paved but are being deferred until this water work can be done.
And one more question, Mayor.
Yes.
If I may be wrong on this, but I thought Broad Street was paved through the Broad Street Parkway funding and not the city paving program.
I think the Broad only the stuff, the area around where the parkway entered the street, but the remainder of the length of it was part of the city paving program, I believe. This is down near Amherst Street.
I'm going to call up Mark Saunders, our
of course,
senior engineer responsible for paving.
So we'll find out.
Mark Saunders, senior staff engineer. That section of Broadway was funded through the federal funds that was repurposed from the Broad Street Parkway.
Yes, repurposed funds. Yes, yeah. Yes. Yes. I thought you meant the main project. Yes, this was all repurposed money. That was complicated, but that's what happened. But still part of the city paving program, even though repurposed.
Yes.
I was just curious about the water line. So when you replace this, you said there's a main up Chautauqua.
Yep.
Do you replace it with the same diameter, or do you put a bigger?
No, sir. By today's standards, the inch and a half is undersized for the number of homes that are serviced by it. So we'll be putting in in this case, a 4-inch water main, more than likely, 4 or 6.
Okay, so a much bigger pipe.
Oh, yes.
And how many of the, you mentioned that there's this, renew all these smaller water mains, get rid of the lead. How many of these streets are there where you think this needs to be done?
An exact number, don't have that off the top of my head, but we have our GIS system kind of.
Well, no exact number. I mean, are we talking 10 or 200 or, you know, just a ballpark?
I would guess 50 streets.
That's what I was going to say, about 50 streets.
Okay. And could this be deferred because of this paving issue and do some other street, or is there some reason that this street should be done?
The reason we're jumping on this one is because the city paving program is about to pave Chautauqua. And if they get in there and pave this, it'll become a moratorium street as well. And the inch and a half is a good tolerance of construction overhead, and it'll have frequent breakage.
Yeah.
We're trying to avoid tearing up moratorium streets when we can.
All right, anybody else?
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Alderman O'Brien.
Thank you. Aaron is at home, so I apologize. I think the mayor asked the size of the pipe. And when you come to upgrade the system, do you have consultation with the fire department, and do you run the flow test for the hydrants and within the distribution so that they meet? Now, I know, like, and not to get ahead, but Reeder Street property goes down to like a little hook of Thomas Street and everything for fire protection. And could that be a concern when you upgrade the existing distribution system?
Chautauqua has one hydrant on it further down the. And that's why we'll run 6-inch all the way down. The pipe that's there presently is unlined 6-inch cast iron, and that has the interior of it is not as smooth for the flow purposes.
Tuberculation, yes.
Exactly. When we do this replacement, it will increase fire flow available.
Good.
At the fire hydrant down that street. Rita Ave is a different situation. It's domestic only.
Oh. Outstanding. Thank you for your answer.
Anyone else? All right, this is item C. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
Motion. We now have item D, Commissioner Shoneman.
I move to consider the hardship request from Penichuk Waterworks to excavate in Ald Street to replace aging infrastructure in advance of city paving.
Ryan Houle, distribution engineer for Penichuk Waterworks. So again, this is similar to item C on Broad Street intersection. So the Reeder Street water main is an inch and a half cement lined, and we're looking to replace that, as Pete mentioned during the discussion regarding item C, in order to remove the lead materials that were once used in water service installation. In addition to that, already by the city paving program. So again, same concept where we're tackling this lead issue and also trying to keep up with the city's paving program and replace mains that are up and due for replacement to allow for the paving, and then, you know, get in there before it's under moratorium. Unfortunately, Ald Street is under moratorium, and that's what we have to do when we replace these side streets, is go and connect to the street that they you know, intersect. So this one is, we're not asking for the one lane only. Ald Street's a little more narrow, so you know, maybe able to deal with the traffic easier as well. Full curb to curb restoration, 20 foot each direction of where we excavate to do the pipe work.
Any discussion, questions? Commissioner Shea.
So as far as the cost to resurface the street, does Penachuk cover that cost or does the city cover that cost?
Penachuk covers the cost. It's actually the mill and over our bid.
Thank you.
Commissioner Shoneman.
Same as before. This is unfortunately a brand new road. It's just over a year old. And you're wanting to replace a water main that be a problem. It's been paved over again and again in the life of its, being there under Rita Street. I think it's good to want to stay ahead of the program and not have to wait, 8 years instead of, getting it done now. But the moratorium was put in place for serve the roads that are, we're about to approve a $4.5 million contract to hopefully to repave the roads. And why are we doing it if we're just going to dig into them again in a year? It doesn't make sense to me. And I feel like it's badly done. Thank you.
I do have a follow-up on that. So what telling us is that they're doing this because of the city paving program. We're about to pave Rita Street, right? Is Rita Street critical? It's a small street that's not traveled very often, whereas Ald Street is a lot of traffic. Do we need to do Rita Street in 2022? Could it be done in 2023 or 2024 or something like that? I guess, yes, I'm directing this to the appropriate person.
Mark Saunders, senior staff engineer. So with the case of Rita Street, as you will see in this presentation over the next couple items, we try to catch streets before they fall into a more costly treatment band. At this point in time, Rita Street is actually in a state of reclamation, so it's on the low end of that spectrum. So over time, it's not going to cost more because it's in the bottom of the bands, opposed to a Chautauqua where that's in a mill state, and if it went any longer, it would slide into a reclamation and cost the city more money due to the extensiveness of that treatment. So it will come back to maintenance of this road since it is in that reclamation state. It's repair, so it has a after this warm day and another snowstorm, I can imagine the potholes that have opened up on it just because of the condition that it is in right now.
So I think what you're saying is that with Chautauqua, we're dealing with a street that needs to be done urgently because we don't want it to decline and require reclamation.
Correct.
Whereas with Rita, we're in the reclamation state now, and deferring it would mean more potholes but would not cost more money because it's got to be reclaimed anyway.
Correct.
And Penachuk is doing this simply because of the city paving program. Rita, you wouldn't be doing this. You'd be doing some other street. You got a lot of streets to do.
We have a lot of streets to do. If you deferred the paving on Rita Street, and we could avoid the curb-to-curb overlay, we'd probably move up to Nye Ave, just up the street.
And you'd want to cut all the streets somewhere else?
Excuse me?
Nye means you'd want to cut into Ald Street.
No, in the instance of Nye Ave, so we'd be just working in Nye Ave.
Okay.
Can I?
Yeah. I mean, that makes, I see where you're going, Mayor. Why don't we just put this project off? Is that what you're saying?
I mean, the residents of Rita Street might not be that happy.
Right, but. It was just paved in 2020, so we right. Still got, two or three years left on the moratorium. Why don't we move on to another street?
But do you think that's wrong?
Well, I just had another quick question. Are we concerned at all about the lead, the potential lead and the impact?
Oh, we're still, yes, on this street, we're still concerned about the lead connections, yes.
And could that have any effect on the water that is consumed?
Well, that's why they want it removed. They want to eliminate the possibility into the water.
But all the streets we're working on have lead, so whether we work on Street A or Street B, we're dealing with a lead issue. It's just which lead street do we go with first, right?
Correct.
What do you think, Mr. Hudson? Let's put him on the spot.
We need to do all this, so it's just a matter of when, right? You know, based on what Mr. Saunders said, I mean, if this was deferred, it's not the end of the world, but I mean, we are geared up, we are planning to do it. Panchuk's ready to do their piece of it, so it's ready to go. But you know, if the board's concerned about the cut in Ald Street, then there's other streets that we could focus on. I don't know. Cuts in these streets do happen, unfortunately, so there may be other cuts in Ald Street for other reasons. When there's emergencies, we just go fix them. We don't have any choice. This isn't an emergency, but I can respect that we want to preserve the you know, the what we funded for repairs to the street. So I see both sides of the issue, and you know, ultimately it's the board's decision on which way to go.
Commissioner Shea.
Is it correct that Penichuk is coordinating with the city, reviewing the paving schedule, reviewing and evaluating different pipe replacement lines, and trying to make the best decision possible, considering all the factors?
Yeah, I won't want to speak for them, but I know that we meet regularly with them. We provide a draft list for look ahead. In our presentation later, Mark Saunders will go through, you know, all the steps we go through when we're evaluating what streets to do and how we choose to do which streets. But you know, they try to keep up with us. They try to do the streets that we want to do. Sometimes things need to get deferred for utility reasons. I mean, they're one utility. There's other utilities and others. There is a lot of coordination that goes into it. I don't think we have any issue with doing the street itself. It's just the problem is these water lines tie in to these other streets that have been done. So, you know, maybe what we need to do is a better job of when we're doing a street, make sure that it gets stubbed out into the side street so we don't have to touch that again. I don't know if we replace the water line on Broad Street or not, but a thought that comes to mind in terms of improvement. But we do an extensive amount of coordination, and Panchuk's been very helpful in working with us and trying to gear their program to keep up with us, because we're doing a good bit of work because we're playing catch up.
Thank you.
Would it okay, Commissioner Lemon?
What's the cost factor? You were saying before that there's a fear that if, you know, the street gets repaved and the replaced, that it could collapse. What's the cost factor differential if the water line collapses? What's the cost to the city? Is it like three times as much?
No, I mean, what Engineer Saunders was referring to is when it slips a category, like in mill and overlay. Do you have a number on the top of your head? Per square. $18 to $22 per square yard. $35 for reclamation, so, you know, 50% more or more if it's slipping a category. In this case, Rita is not slipping a category. If Panchuk has a main break and they need to go out and do a restoration, they go out, they make the repair, they do the pavement restoration. It's all them, so it doesn't cost us anything except additional aggravation to the public, you know, and whatever disruption that causes. It's not so much a cost issue for us in terms of timing, in this case with Rita, because it's already in poor condition, so.
Right.
It's going to stay in poor condition until it's fixed.
Well,
so
there's also the aggravation to the homeowners who
have
lost water. So I'm sure they're trying to prevent that as well.
Now, Mike, would it be a problem to defer this for a month to kind of just so we could check out Rita Street?
Does
that cause a problem?
Nope.
Do you think
I think that's more than reasonable.
No.
Well, what would you think of that, to let us look at, check it out? I mean, you know, I know where Rita Street is, but I've never focused on.
I was trying to figure out where exactly. I'm familiar with Alt Street.
It's kind of lower Alt Street.
So pretty far down.
It's a little street off to the east.
Okay.
Down near.
Okay.
What do you think? Commissioner Moriarty?
I was just going to make that motion, Mayor, if there's no other.
Commissioner Shea, may I?
Commissioner Shea?
I was just going to say, you know, I don't know that further investigation of this issue is going to yield a different outcome in terms of the assessment. I know that this is a very complex. These schedules and coordination between the city and Penichuk and other utilities are extensive and involved. I would not be surprised if they came back next month and told us that the same thing was recommended. So short of any glaring issue, I understand that it's not ideal to be disturbing new roads or small section. But I also understand that it's not a perfect world. And either way, I'm fine, but I that's my thought.
Now, Commissioner Moriarty, was that a motion to hold it?
I was going to make that motion, Mayor, to hold it.
Was or you are?
I am.
Okay, you make the motion to defer this or table this till the next meeting? Discussion on the motion to table? All those in favor of that, say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? All right, so the motion passes, and we will table it to the next meeting. Thank you very much. All right, and we're on, what are we on now? Item E. Item E, Commissioner Lemon.
I motion to approve the award of the citywide pedestrian infrastructure conditions assessment and ranking contract to Nashua Regional Planning Commission, an RPC of Nashua, New Hampshire, in the amount of $42,500. Funding will be through Department 161 Streets Fund Bond Activity.
So thank you again, Dan Hudson, City Engineer. This the city has an extensive amount of sidewalk. I don't want to be quoted, but I believe it's on the order of 150 miles. But we don't have a great inventory currently exactly what condition all that sidewalk's in. Obviously, we know we have areas where we need improvement. What this contract would do would contract with the National Regional Planning Commission to work with us to go do a complete inventory. Data, we would basically walk all the sidewalk segments and all that information would be collected, entered into GIS in according with the accordance with the state standard statewide asset data exchange system. In 2020, we partnered with NRPC to do a citywide pedestrian level service analysis, which is a similar sort of a thing, more on how people feel about traveling on different segments, how safe it is they feel, and things like that. This would actually be going out and collecting specific data, which would inform a future transition plan where we can really define what it is on these sidewalks and prioritize which ones should be worked on first. So that's the proposal. I'll be happy to entertain any questions.
Questions, discussion? Commissioner Shoneman.
I think you just answered my first question was, the contract in 2020 was a little more broad, not as specific, and this one detailed.
Yeah, this one, that previous one looked at about 17 miles. This one's gonna be really focused on the ADA compliance issues. That one, it looked at, you know, biking and where we maybe want to add additional bike accommodation, those sorts of things. This study here is really focused on the ADA and sidewalk issues.
And this may sound odd. Is there anyone involved on the Regional Planning Commission, anyone that's going to be involved in this project who actually has a disability?
It's a fair question. I don't know. I mean, what's envisioned is they usually hire interns in the summer, so they're gonna hire an intern and provide a two-person crew, and then the city's gonna do the same. We're gonna provide a two-person crew. They'll kind of manage that collection effort, but we'll both provide workforce to help do all that data collection. So. It's a push. Originally, they were looking at, you know, splitting this over 2 years, but given the sidewalk needs we have, I pushed hard to get this data collection done this first year, and then we can enter into next year really nailing down our transition plan. So that's the plan.
I think it's an excellent idea. Our sidewalks are kind of rough, and I think that just as a recommendation, choosing someone with a lot of skin in the game, someone who every day travels the sidewalks, you know, using wheels instead of as a pedestrian, I think would be very eye-opening. That we'd fall short of the mark if we didn't at least include input from people who really do have skin in the game.
That's a good point. I want to point out part of this will be a public, you know, outreach phase of the project. We're going to collect a bunch of data, but we're also going to seek that input. One of the aspects they're going to do is, you know, use a web-based system where people can go put a dot on the map. You know, there's a problem for me here. So it'll be a great, and they're accustomed to doing these studies and the public engagement part of it extensively. So it'll be a great way to kind of gather up what all the problems are, and then we can work in a better fashion to address them.
Commissioner Lemon.
Can you say a little bit more about that? Because I'm a person who walks a lot in the city, and I have a dog. So I tend to have trying to avoid other people if they're afraid of dogs or whatever. But so are you going to just also, so there'll be like a map, and I could go in and say, I walked from Auld Street to such and such place, and this is what I found?
Yep. You'll be able to put a pin on the map. Okay. Type in whatever you want to say, whatever your issue is. Maybe there'll be categories, you know, categorize it in certain categories, but it'll be that type of thing. The cost that we're seeking to approve is a license for software to do that. It's a software that they used before. I think they used it on that previous study. I know we've done cities done similar things with the master planning process where they provided that sort of an opportunity, and there'll be opportunity as well in as we present this to you folks and the results of the study. There'll be opportunity for public input in this format.
Oh, I think it's great. I think it's a great idea.
Commissioner Shea.
I think Commissioner Shoneman makes a great point, and that was not top of mind for me. And so to keep folks with disabilities in mind, I think is great. And so thank you for that. The folks at Cravings Cafe, Gateways Community Services, and the Plus Company outreach to during this process. I think that all three of those outfits can help get some of that kind of great feedback that we need. I also want to remark that I think that this is a good effort to ensure that sidewalk replacement and new sidewalk starts is done in an equitable way that balances people's needs. As well as the conditions of the service. It's really great that we're doing this work, and I appreciate that we are paying attention to this. I live in French Hill, and like many places in the city, we have very old sidewalks, and it just to do this work, to make the assessment, and then create kind of a background of information for seeking funds, federal funds, and otherwise. All around, so thank you.
Further to your point, we do have a specific project for Locke and Whitney Street that will be coming forward soon. It'll be starting soon, but that is one of those such programs. It has state federal funding matched with city funding, so we'll be looking specifically at improvements in that area soon.
Thank you.
All right, any other? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed. Item F, Commissioner Shea.
The motion is to approve the award of the construction contract for the 2022 paving program to Sunshine Paving Corporation of Hudson, New Hampshire, in the amount of $4,562,802. Funding will be through Department 160, Admin, Engineering, Funds, Bond, and Trust, Activity, Paving, and Department 169, Wastewater, Funds, Bond, and Wastewater, Activities, Sewer Rehab, and Stormwater Abatement.
So, as noted, there was a number of our annual paving program. All the funding is in hand. The bond funding referenced is for previous paving bonds that have already been approved. Some of the funding is contributing funding with utilities when they're doing work on a street that we know we're going to reclaim. We'll take a contribution so that they don't do a patch and then we just go through and grind it up. You know, that wouldn't make sense. So, anyway, so it's a whole assortment of funding. There's some wastewater funding for replacing manhole covers and such that are part of the wastewater system. So we bid this project out this year and received three bids. Bids were fairly close and in line with what we expected. Sunshine Paving was the low bidder. They've done our paving the last 2 years, and we've had good success with them, so we're recommending award to them.
Discussion. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Item G is informational. Any questions, comments on that? And so now we have the presentation regarding the paving plan of action, so to speak.
Okay, great. Thank you, Diane. So we're here to provide an update, basically, on the paving program. With me, again, is Mark Saunders. He's a senior engineer with the engineering department. Mark is tasked with managing this program, so he's intimately familiar with all the details, and we'll go through some of for how we select streets and that sort of thing. This presentation tonight will give you an update on what we've accomplished in the first 5 years of the program. This was set out as a 10-year program, and we bonded the first 5 years of it. And so we're looking to complete the 10-year program, and we'll show what we accomplished in that first 5 years and the basis for continuing with it. So. Next slide, paving history. Before 2017, the city would pave around 6 to 8 miles of roadway or less annually. At that rate, the city was losing ground on the overall paving network because paving, like a lot of things, continually degrades, right? It's impacted by weather, traffic, trucks pounding on it, all those sorts of things. It doesn't stay in a steady state. It continually declines, so it's important to keep up with it, right? The 10-year plan was proposed, as I said, the first 5 years was approved and funded. During that first 5 years, we resurfaced around 113 miles of the city network, and we have around 311 total, so about a third of the city has been recently. I'm going to turn it over to Mark, who can go into some of those additional details.
Thank you. Mark Saunders, Senior Staff Engineer. So as Engineer Hutchins said, we have around about 311 miles of publicly accepted roadways. The 311 miles are then broken up into about 1,500 roadway segments. A pavement condition score, also known as a PCI, one of these segments. And the PCI score ranges from 0 to 100, 100 being the best, 0 being the worst. Each one of these PCI falls within a treatment band condition. And that treatment band is the extensive repair that the road is required. Understanding these conditions on each roadway segments allows models to be developed to determine budget that reflect current conditions. PCI is an international standard with a specific calculation methodology. The city contracts outside pavement specialists for this assessment. Each year, a third of the city's pavement network is reevaluated. This last year, the northern third, or the blue as shown on the map, was the area that was surveyed. Thank you. So when I talk about our treatment band examples that correlate to these PCI ranges, these are the five that are proposed. This tool is used as a starting point in street selection and helps determine the proper treatment and life expectancy of a roadway. There are five defined treatment bands as shown, and as increases, the treatments required get more extensive and expensive. The do-nothing band consists of a PCI score in the 90s. This is when a road is in a state where no further action is necessary. As shown here, the do-nothing photo is from Danforth Road, which was paved in 2020. At the other end of the spectrum is the base rehabilitation band. This correlates to a score less than 20. These are the worst roads in the network and require extensive reclamation projects. As shown for the base rehabilitation is French Street. The primary goal of pavement management is to optimally repair a roadway before the repair costs get significantly greater. The treatment band guidelines help determine which repair treatment a roadway should receive. Street selection. I know we touched on a little bit of this in the previous motions. The street selection process is very dynamic and requires coordination between multiple parties. The first step in the street selection process is to analyze the PCI data to develop a preliminary list. The PCI data is the first to determine the condition of the roadway and recommendations for pavement treatment. Once a preliminary street list has been developed, it then needs to be cleared and reviewed for utility conflicts. Under the pavement is a vast network of utilities that consist of gas, water, sewer, and storm facilities that need to be cleared through a coordination screening effort before the roadway can be paved. The engineering department works in-house screening sewer and the main source of this information is through the use of video inspection. The infrastructure is reviewed for any damage that would require an open excavation. If that is found to be determined, paving is deferred until that correction can be made. The engineering department also works closely with other utilities such as Liberty and Penichuk to align their capital projects with the paving schedule. This is the last operation on the roadway. Projected paving lists are sent to these utilities in advance before a final street selection is put into a contract and goes out to bid. In conjunction with clearing the roads of any utility conflicts, a field review is done on each street that is potentially going to make the final street list. This field review is to verify that the treatment prescribed matches the actual real-time road condition. The field review also assesses drainage issues, ADA compliance, and constructability. The constructability aspect of the review is to determine if any other roads in the neighborhood are of similar condition to limit the footprint of the construction during that contract, as well as the disturbance to neighborhoods. This also builds an attractive contract and generates competitive bids. Once all these items are completed, a final street list is prepared within the defined budget. So in addition to resurfacing, we have preventative maintenance that we are starting to ramp up since our network has of paving. As that improves, this preservation and maintenance should increase as well. The first one we talk about is crack sealing. This treatment is currently being used throughout the city of Nashua. Over the past several years, we've done about 102 miles of crack sealing. Crack sealant is the application of an asphalt rubber compound to seal cracks and prevent moisture from entering, leading to further degradation. The next item is a fog seal. A fog seal is a full-width topical rejuvenator that penetrates the pavement and softens the asphalt binder to bind it to the aggregates to slow oxidation, limit raveling, and to seal minor cracks. This technology has recently been piloted last year, and we intend to continue with the fog seal into this construction. Next is microsurfacing. This is a proven treatment used by other neighborhood communities. Microsurfacing is a mixture of polymer modified asphalt emulsion and aggregate installed in two thin lifts on a properly prepared roadway surface. And this provides skid resistance, restricts moisture intrusion, protects the underlying structure from oxidation and raveling, and the treatment Lastly, on the slide is the bonding wearing course. This is the most similar to a hot mix overlay. This is a spray pair application of polymodified asphalt emulsion combined with an ultra-thin gap-graded hot mix asphalt overlay. This seals the underlying pavement, including small cracks, minor rutting, and surface imperfections, and restores road. These are some of the tools that we are looking to get cost savings into our paving program and to keep the good roads good. So when a street gets selected for paving, we do like to take a complete streets approach. A complete street approach is taken on each road so that when the street is finalized, it is complete. When possible, our sidewalk access, roadway drainage, traffic detection, sign replacement, pavement markings, and casting replacement. An effort is being made to reconstruct ADA access ramps within the project limits of streets selected for paving to be compliant with the American with Disabilities Act. Existing drainage issues are evaluated before and during Existing drainage issues are evaluated before and during construction and corrected where feasible. The extent of the drainage correction is directly related to the treatment on the road. Streets that are reclaimed have drainage corrections will be corrected. When it's a mill and overlay, there's certain constraints we're tied to because it's not as an extensive repair. Major intersections are evaluated for traffic detection systems to help with traffic. We'll have underground detection loops replaced. An effort is being made to replace damaged or faded regulatory signs. And lastly, non-standard drain and catch basins are being replaced. At this time, I'll turn the presentation over to City Engineer Dan Hudson.
Thank you, Mark. So just to kind of recap what's been done to date, as I said, 13 miles. This map here shows all the streets that we have paved during that time, about 520 streets. Of the 113 miles that's been paved, about 32 of that has been on Ontario roadways and 81 on residential roadways. In addition to resurfacing the roadways, 102 miles of road or on about 400 streets has been crack sealed to investment. Hit the button, Diane, forward. We got a little animation to jump forward here. So here's a graph of what we accomplished. That's a graph of how the PCI has changed since 2016, and it's jumped 11 points. So that's evidence of the positive impact in road conditions that this paving program has had throughout the city. This year's program, 2022, we're going to resurface 14 miles of roadways. Focusing on residential streets, 65 streets worth. We have about 3 miles of carryover paving from 2021 that we couldn't complete due to weather and utility issues and other. So that'll be done. Crack seal 10 miles, fog seal 5 miles, microsurface about a mile. We intend, can you advance? Okay, go one more, Diane. So looking forward, we've been going at a $7.5 million a year per first 5 years. If we continue that, you can see the projection, conditions will continue to improve. the backlog, which is, you know, the amount of work left to be done will continue to decrease. Next slide. So that's our recommendation. Our recommendation is that the city should continue. It should carry forward and complete the 10-year paving program by requesting another five-year bond or approving another five-year bond. We should continue to expand routine and preventive maintenance. As Mark said, you want to keep the good roads good, and it's important to do so. And we want to continue with this pavement management approach that we've undertaken. I think we've, over the 5 years, we've worked hard to refine our process. It's a fairly good process, and it's working well. So that's the conclusion. I'd be happy to entertain any questions.
Anyone? Commissioner Shoneman.
What is our average PCI right now? You said it's gone up 11 points. What is it right now? Is it 60?
I think it's 7.
Yeah,
seven.
It's, it it's 78.4.
That's good.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Yep. Great.
Improved from, like I said, 11 points. It was 67.5, and now it's about 78.5. So, and you, when you think about the whole city, we've done 113 miles, but there's a lot more streets we haven't got to. There's 2/3 of the streets we haven't even touched, right? So that's, we focused on early years on the arterial roadways. Those typically are wider, so that work has had a big impact on the PCI score on average for the whole city.
Commissioner Moriarty.
Yeah, thank you. That very nice presentation, excellent. The question I had was, we're all in agreement that we don't want to cut into roads that have been paved, you know, with the moratorium, you know, whenever possible. But when we do,
it degrades the PCI. Like the PCI is a whole methodology in how it gets calculated, right? Every crack contributes towards a worse PCI. So when you cut into a roadway, you add seams. Even if you restore the pavement, you add seams. You know, by the nature, you don't have a fresh, clean anymore. So it does decrease the PCI of the roadway. You know, if you have a section of the roadway, you pave the whole thing, you improve the PCI to 100 or near 100. If you have a small patch along, it doesn't take it from a 100 down to a 60, but yeah, it certainly does have an impact.
And as a follow-up, Mayor, so when we do cut into these roads, are we using the highest technology so it doesn't degrade? I mean, I don't know what the modern technology is, but you know, you have a lot of different approaches out there, and I just didn't know.
Yeah, I alluded to it earlier. It's one of the things I want to come in and have a whole nother presentation on that. What we're doing is a pretty good restoration, but it's fairly extensive. And there may be other ways. Right now, we're on each side of the trench and replacing the gravels and the full pavement. Well, that's great. That makes for a very stable area. But what I worry about is the transition match into the rest of the pavement. I don't want a seam that goes all the way through the pavement to the lower layer, because, you know, we can crack seal it, but eventually that's going to open up, and it's going to be an avenue for water to get into the road, which is detrimental. I mean, the water is one of the biggest traffic. Water in your roadway is one of the biggest contributors to roadways, you know, deteriorating. So we have some ideas. We're gonna come in hopefully next month, and we'll present what some other communities are doing and what we're currently doing, and then maybe suggest some changes for consideration.
Thank you.
Commissioner Shea.
With the product, it's for kind of resurfacing small patches, potholes or what have you. That's like an infrared plate, maybe like a 3x3 or 4x4 infrared plate that you treat and heat down a couple of inches, rake it, and then roll it so that you eliminate that that transition.
Yes, we are familiar with that, and we do use it. Sometimes like manhole, so there's a paved over manhole that we got to restore. So if it works well in fairly new pavement, If you have an older pavement that's, you know, over the years, many years, is hardened, it doesn't work as well with that. But for fairly new pavement, that does work pretty well.
And I understand that the bigger deployments of the technology allow you to do hot patches during cold weather even. I think the more that we can be using something like that, that's great. My comment is that, you know, we've come a long way as far as our roads go. Looking back to 2013, 14, 15 was like peak disaster for Nashua roads. I just want to commend you for all your work. You really got this down to a science, and I don't know that was that level back then. And also to the mayor and the Board of Aldermen and everybody who served through this process. It's been a many-year process. Just paying attention to it, coming up with the system, funding the system, and getting us to a place where we're not perpetually, like, there are still potholes. There's definitely some this year with the temperature fluctuations, but you've all done a great job. So
the credit goes to our contractors, to our staff. Mark has been instrumental in managing the program, so credit to him. It's nice to be able to be talking about not wanting to cut the new pavement versus, you know, having meetings about how terrible the pavement is on roads, right? So it's nice to be kind of on the other side of that and having those you know, good issues to talk about. So we appreciate it.
Commissioner Shoneman.
I don't want to belabor the point. I just wanted to confirm my not so wonderful memory. I think I remember hearing when I first joined the board that when you cut into a road, excuse me, in its first year of life, you reduce its something like 33%. Is that correct?
I don't know if the percentage is correct offhand, but you're absolutely correct. The earlier you cut into it, the, you know, worse off it is for the road. You know, the one of the things we'll be talking about is street damage fees. And that's something that's been discussed with the board before. We never have gotten to the point we've actually implemented them. But envision that those fees would be higher if it's earlier in the program. You know, if you cut a road that's younger, those fees would be higher to account for that additional impact. You are correct. I don't have those percentages, but you know, and again, if you cut in one area, you're not cutting the whole street. So there's still a lot of streets in that area. You definitely cuts. If you repair them, it's never going to be as good as when you had the paving company there with the paving machine and the whole setup, and they did a full paving program. So it does have an impact, and we can share some information on that.
Excellent. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for all of this good work you've done over 5 years, really.
Thank you.
So we will be bringing in a resolution to ask the Board of Aldermen to fund the next 5 years of the paving program. So that will come back here for a recommendation. So you'll be seeing that hopefully soon.
All right. Item I is informational. Does anybody have any comments on that? If not, we'll go to administration and the director's report.
Okay. If you can advance to the first slide, Diane. The next slide. We're having technical difficulties here.
She's doing that fine.
Diana.
Oh,
there we go.
Where is she?
She's remote.
Oh, she is?
Yeah. It's amazing what you can do with technology, huh? She did the paving presentation, too.
Oh, she did?
Yeah. So this is a gas main installation on Main Street, a new 12-inch plastic installed by Liberty Utilities and their contractor, Feeney Brothers. The work is going to continue into the spring. Two sewer pipes were lined under the Nashua Country Club fairways on February 15th by Green Mountain Pipeline Services. Our video showed that they were in very poor condition and at the point for ready for collapse. So we lined this was an emergency sewer replacement on 41 Alder Drive that was performed on January 27th by Chris Contracting. And we will complete the pavement restoration during the warmer months. Our Biddy basketball program has had an outstanding season. It is now over, and we're preparing for our spring. Pictured top left to right are the Nationals, the Panthers, and the Blue Devils. And the bottom left to right are the Warriors and the Wildcats. So it was nice to see everybody back playing Biddy basketball again this year. This is just a picture of our city sidewalk plowing. The crews are, of course, are busy clearing sidewalks after storms. Pictured on the left is a sidewalk near Elementary on Arlington Street. This is just some plowing during the winter storm Keenan on January 29th. Street crews are milling out some areas. I think it was Commissioner Shea that mentioned the potholes that we're seeing. This is the time of year when we have thaws. We are still doing our mill and fill program, and we did mill out some areas that we're finding had frequent potholes. So this works really well in preventing that from continuing to happen. Our household hazardous waste collection schedule is available online at the Solid Waste Department. Our first household hazardous waste collection is April 23rd from 8 to 12, and they will again be held on Crown Street, the Crown Street Park side. And we received our three new trash trucks, one automated and two packers on January 26th. So those have already been put into action. And I don't see the slide of that, but there they are. So, and that's it. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Anybody? Commissioner Shea.
I have 2 points of comment. One being I very much appreciate Mary Teresa Freund coming to the meeting tonight to help raise our thinking about composting. I know Lisa responded to her with a very thoughtful email about what the city has been doing and some of the things that the city's been looking at. Hopeful to see that conversation continue and see,
yep,
you know, what more we can do. It's certainly a worthwhile thing to be thinking about. So thank you to Mary Teresa for coming tonight. And my other point of comment is that it appears that the city's YourGov online service ticket submission system is due to wrap up. I believe that the contractor is no longer providing the service, or the software company, or what have you. And I've talked with Director Foto about this before, but the idea of implementing C-Click Fix, which is a very novel smartphone application that geotags and for various items that people want to submit, whether it's Department of Public Works related or otherwise. I'd love to see us make more forward progress on that, especially with the other service phasing out. What made me think about it is, you know, kind of brought it to the top of mind, is I received an email from a constituent about a tire blowout on Amherst, and they were trying to get more information on when it was initially reported, as there are some amount of state statutes relative to a window within which you've got to do markings and these things. I think that implementing that C-Click Fix will be great for convenience, but also as a matter of accountability, creating tickets that people can track would be great for Nashua, for everybody. So thank you.
So I have great news on that.
Yeah.
I expect that we'll have that, and Diane's on the phone. She's been working very hard with a group of people. I believe within hopefully a month, but the latest 2 months, CClickFix will be implemented.
Oh, fantastic.
So it's more work than we expected. We had hoped to have it online before now, but we're now, and hopefully within a month, two at the most. Is that correct, Diane?
Yes, I'd say that's accurate.
So, and I agree with you. It's going to be a great tool. I think residents will really.
I'm so happy to hear that. Thank you.
Yeah.
Commissioner Moriarty.
Thank you, Mayor. I would just say I'd like to thank whoever was in charge, maybe engineering department, with this new format for the. I just like the way that's written instead of all the hundreds of numbers that we typically read out in the motion. It just says as listed in the staff memo. I just it's nice and clean and just nice.
Great. Commissioner Shoneman.
I want to add my support for the municipal composting. I know it's not free. I mean, anything like this, it's figure out how to fund it and how to staff it and all those things.
Right.
My mother-in-law lives in Vermont, and she was not excited about having what she calls forced composting. And I would have to agree with her. It's a great thing. To make it mandatory is a little draconian, but I think it's a wonderful thing. I love and buying compost every year is no good. And I didn't even know about the city's compost bins. I wasn't even aware of that, so I'm ashamed that I didn't know that. But I really would like to talk to Grow Nashua and see what they do and how they do it, how they create the compost from what they're given, and how we could maybe ramp it up based on that. Interesting to be a part of that.
Well,
they have come in before, but it's been a while. So we can have them come in again. Justin Monroe is the guy, and I'm sure he'd be glad to come back.
Mm-hmm. Well, the other thing I appreciated to add to the other commissioners' comments about that was Teresa's emphasis on equity, that, you know, if you're living in an apartment, you know, so it would have to be a really, and you know, nobody wants to be forced to compost. I mean, but you know, I compost, but my daughter is a really avid gardener, so and yells at me if I accidentally put a potato peel in the wrong place. But I and she's worked with Grow Nashua, so I think Justin would be really happy to do it. And if we could come up with a way that we get, I mean, and one place that I see would be a really good place to maybe do some initial. Nashua is already working with the schools to get the schools to start composting their food waste, because that's going to be a lot of food waste in certain places that would be, you know, a pickup that would
all in one place.
Yeah.
A ton of stuff all in one place. Yeah.
So
okay, anyone else? Commissioners' comments?
I do have a question.
Shoneman?
A lot of buzz, a lot of talk about the downtown barriers and what the decisions are going to be for that. A vast majority, and you know, it's anecdotal, but a vast majority of what I've read, people are not in favor of them. And I understand that there is a proposed plan to go ahead for another 3 years, the barriers. And I was wondering what our role is in being a part of that plan. As far as I know, there was no meeting posted of the Downtown Improvement Committee meeting with economic development. There was no posted meeting, no agenda. As far as I know, I don't know what the results of that were. Know if we as commissioners are going to have a role. There's some part of it that's in our purview and some part that's in the Board of Aldermen's purview. So do we know what's what?
I think, first of all, Alderman O'Brien's going to, I think, talk to this because the proposed compromise plan is pending before the Board of Aldermen. The infrastructure is going to be held on March 9th.
Okay.
But in terms of the role of the two boards, The permitting on the sidewalks is within the purview of the Board of Public Works. There are certain parameters and a permit process. In terms of the closing of the street, that is an alderman. Alderman.
Interesting. How does that work?
I don't know. You'd have to talk to the city attorney.
All right.
Anyway, but Alderman O'Brien has...
Yeah, if I could just basically what the battle plan, probably bad phraseology with it, because when you talk to people when it comes down to the downtown, you do have businesses that come up and they say, I'm losing money. And then you do have businesses come up and say, I'm doing quite well. I need the barriers. Who do you believe? So there has been a lot. Then you got also people that have come up without any official records or professional, or but they just go down Main Street and their snapshot of the moment. Well, such and such a restaurant wasn't busy that day. And that's just a snapshot. It doesn't mean that other particular time. I mean, it could have been a snapshot of, you know, 8 o'clock in the morning, which isn't a traditional time. So anyways, we're going to hear on March 9th with a joint EC. The intention is probably to listen to people come in and make their pleas and presentation. And at that particular time, I think what we'll do is we're working on a format to maybe have, a committee, don't want to say committee, but people from infrastructure, people from PEDC, maybe talk to the mayor and talk to Director Cummings, and maybe somebody from Public Works to come on to, you know, to discuss it. Because seeking information and coming from the public does not have an engineering department like we have. They don't have a traffic department such as that we have. And I was looking for something to put on the plate, so adjust it and try to make the best decision on the process as possible. And so there was a lot of in-house work groups and everything on this. It has been brought out. If people look at it, some of the things is around the area, Peddler's Daughters, eliminating the right turn onto, the Canal Street will be a right turn, but the bump out car at Peddler's, that was a little bit of an issue. By eliminating that in front of Peddler's Daughter, I think that will clear a lot of problems. Other problems were people coming out from intersections when the light wasn't proper and blocking the intersection, which is in violation of state motor vehicle law. And we got cooperation from the police department. They will send officers down to assist us. So as we go farther down, we are learning on this, you know, to come up. And we came up, I think the mayor agrees, maybe not, but basically a true compromise. That's what the people said. We got a lot of testimony that says, like to have a compromise on this, and let's see if they really mean, you know, and I think we came up with a plan. There's got to be not as many barriers and everything else, but we've heard different things from the artwork and everything else like that, and it's still work in progress. Got to have a conversation of what to do with the artwork on the barriers, you know. I'm willing to come out. I'll grab my paintbrush and paint over if that's what's needed, but take a look and see. So March 9th is the date, and after that we'll look into forming a committee. That's still kind of raw data that's out there, but we just got to hear there isn't going to be a decision made by the board with a recommendation. It's not my intention, unless the board seems to commit to that, but it's to listen to the public input on it, pros and cons. So the public will have to weigh in.
Answer your question a bit,
please.
I think there are a lot of people who support this. I mean, the Board of Aldermen have been last week flooded with emails in favor of the downtown dining. And why would we do this? Everybody agrees that bringing people downtown creates more business, creates more vitality. And the counts done last summer showed that 3,000 to 4,000 people a day took advantage of the expanded outdoor dining. So we're really talking about, you know, it sounds like a lot, but hundreds of thousands of people that came downtown. Now, the effort, the restaurants over the other businesses. First of all, the effort is to build a stronger, healthier downtown economy. And bringing millions of dollars to Main Street that didn't exist before is a big boost to downtown. Now, there are retailers out there who will tell you they had record sales during the pandemic for various reasons, but in part because of the expanded outdoor dining and all the people that have. So it's, but people have expressed concerns, traffic, parking.
Response time of the fire department.
Now they have signed off on, so we came up with a compromise plan, which you should look at. It does eliminate the barriers and the expanded outdoor dining in the places where the traffic congestion is most acute and where people on the street have objected the most regarding the parking issues. So the main changes, but there are other reductions. But and you should go on the 9th or watch it, and you see the details. But the main changes are the proposal is to limit the barriers and the expanded outdoor dining in front of peddlers, even though they would like it, to have a beneficial effect on the constriction that kind of results at Canal Street and backs up all the way. And another significant change is on the west side of the block between Factory and Water, where there have been some objections, to eliminate everything except for the outdoor dining and have just regular parking. Go Kitchen. They really want it. They're saying they'll go out of business without it. A bunch of their servers and the like came last night to the Infrastructure Committee and talked about how they really need this to support their whole families. And these are not people who make a lot of money. These are hardworking people who make a modest income. There are some other changes. Going back a little bit, it would add about 20 or so space. They're added parking on Factory Street. So the net effect last year was a loss of 70 parking spaces out of about 3,000 downtown. This year, if the compromise plan were adopted, it would be a loss of about 44 spaces, a net loss of 44. So the number of handicapped spaces has never been reduced. It's always been the same number of handicapped spaces. So I think overall the point is not to benefit the restaurants particularly, but it's to grow more revenue, bring in millions of dollars, have a stronger tax base. So that is the theory, and I think the last two summers have shown the reality behind the project. Now, I get that some people think it's not a good idea, and so we've tried to scale it back to accommodate some of those concerns.
Alderman. Oh, go ahead.
Excuse me. Yeah, if I may, in reply to Commissioner, Shoneman, there's a lot of information and opinions out there, and you know, I hate to say it, being an Irishman, I sometimes don't let my opinions get in the way of facts, but we have to deal with facts with this. And the fire department. You've got to keep in mind, this program's been out there for 2 years. If the police department or fire department or somebody else came forward and brought up safety concerns, believe me, they would have been mitigated. But that really wasn't the case. They have been, quite frankly, welcomed, and this is, I'm talking both the police and fire, and I'm sure Director Fodor can say she had some participation with. Been, you know, very good, you know, great response from people in our city and trying to come together with a plan so we could present it to the people, you know. So to dispel all the, you know, different things or their opinions, it would be best if they come March 9th and then to hear the facts and like the mayor says. And the thing is, I would like to remind people on handy. Every parking space is a handicapped parking space, according to the state of New Hampshire RSA. If you have a handicapped placard, you can park in that particular space. But we keep in mind that certain businesses in different areas, it is best to have those handicapped parking designated. And in other words, you can't park there unless you're placarded, but if somebody with a handicapped plate can, you know what I mean? And so, I mean, I'm very proud with, to give kudos to the people that have worked on this. I think we have something that everybody can take a look at. Compromises were made, and I think we have a good product that will be presented to the public on March 9th. And whether it passes or fails, nothing is guaranteed, but I think we have something that people can see factually on what is best for the town. Thank you.
My last comment or question. Certainly people want to be educated in what's being put forward and the implications and the different sides of the argument, the people who are for it and the people who are against it want to know, you know, for certain what's being planned. And where can they find that information?
So there's a resolution, or excuse me, a proposed ordinance. I forget, I think it's like 022, it might be like 03 or something, but it's in the legislative. If you go to the Board of Aldermen, there's proposed ordinances. And if you click, there aren't many that are pending. So you, and attached to that ordinance is a plan that indicates what is being suggested. So it shows, you know, where the expanded outdoor dining would be, where the parking would be, and gives you a pretty good idea of what is proposed.
Okay. And is there where they can find the input from the different businesses as to the emails and things that were sent
well,
in favor
that stuff
or
shows
against?
Up on the as an attachment to the to the periodic minutes of the Board of Aldermen, because all the stuff seems to be, it's coming into the Board of Aldermen. So if you look at the, or excuse me, the not the minutes, the agenda of the last meeting of the Board of Aldermen, which was two days ago, February 22nd, you'll see emails. A lot of emails have come in since then, and those will be attached to the agenda of the March 8th meeting of the Board of Aldermen.
Okay. You said public comment at the meeting on March 9th.
Yes, but to fall, I mean, everybody has hearth and home, and I anticipate it'll be a lot of people. So we'll follow the customary, which is the rule of 3 minute, you know, comment period. And yeah, so everybody will have an entitlement to speak, even if we're there when we're watching the sun come up, you know, within reason. But keeping it at the 3 minutes, I think that is adequate time, you know, to state their particular concerns, you know. And then also, too, I mean, the 3 minutes and everything else, that doesn't stop a citizen to contacting via talk to their favorite alderman or send an email on the matter.
Absolutely.
Equally yes. As well, too.
Yes.
And so, you know, there's many ways that the public can let us know. Like the mayor said, we did petitions came in under communications last night. So they are on file. All the aldermen are getting them and will be presented. Kudos again to our administrative assistant, Donna Graham. You know, the photo was sick. Pro and con, you know, and she's on top of it. God bless her. So doing good.
Now, it might be, in terms of public, plan was not on the infrastructure agenda last night, but people pro and con came in and spoke to the infrastructure committee last night. It's on the, you know, it's on the website, the recording. It's kind of interesting because you got people on, some people opposed, people definitely in favor, and might be just, you know, if you're into it, checking that out. The public comment period lasts, you know, 20 minutes, I don't know, half hour. So it's not, yeah, it's not, you know, a huge commitment to watch it.
And it will be on Zoom. Zoom.
Commissioner Moriarty.
Yes, to this extent, Mayor, Public Works is involved with this to some extent because of the placement of the barriers and everything. The final plan that, you know, as an informational item, we put it on our agenda, so we're abreast of what the final plan is.
No problem. We could give you whether the I don't know when the alderman will vote on this.
Yep.
You know, but we could definitely get a presentation of the proposed compromise plan to the next meeting of the Board of Public Works. That's no problem. Whether it's passed or whether it's still pending,
yeah,
or whether it was defeated, you know, whatever. If it's, I mean, I think it will pass, but so I guess if it doesn't, what's the point? But we can definitely get a proposal, you know, a presentation here,
sure,
at the next meeting. In fact, we should have done it already. Now that you bring it up, but it, the Board of Aldermen on Tuesday, so.
Yeah.
And I think if Director Foto makes a request to Economic Development Director,
we can get him to come.
Mr. Cummings, I think it could be filtered out to the proper email channels to you.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, we can get it.
Definitely.
I'll talk to Tim.
Yeah. Thank you. Any other commissioners? All right. Where are we?
Personnel.
Item A, Commissioner Moriarty.
I move to accept the retirement of Chris Nelson, a city welder, effective March 18th, 2022.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Item B, Commissioner Shoneman.
I move to accept the resignation of Kelly D. Simone, Recreation Program Manager, effective March 2, 2022.
Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Motion passes. Item C, Commissioner.
Motion is to approve and unseal the non-public minutes for personnel from the Board of Public Works meeting of January 20th, 2022.
Discussion. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 Motion passes. Non-public session. I think Commissioner Moriarty has a motion on that.
Commissioner Moriarty, I didn't go over that with you before, but we have this evening.
Sure.
Do you think we have to do them separately?
Yes.
All right, so we got two of them.
So we do the personnel, non-public.
Yeah. Why don't you come up, Andy?
Would you mind making that first motion?
The personnel, yes. I move by roll call that the board go into non-public session pursuant to RSA 91A3, Roman numeral 2B, person as a public employee.
Commissioner Moriarty?
Yes.
Commissioner Shoneman?
Yes.
Commissioner Lemon?
Yes.
Commissioner Shea?
Yes.
Yes. So we're now going to go into non-public session, and the video should go off until we come back.
Seconded.
All right. There's been a motion to go out. All those in favor of the motion say, come out of non-public. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes, and we're now in public session again.
I move by roll call to seal the minutes of the Board of Public Works Personnel non-public meeting of February 24, 2022, until such time as the majority of the board votes that the purpose of the confidentiality will no longer.
Is this a roll call?
Yes, roll call.
Yes.
Roll call.
Commissioner Moriarty?
Yes.
Commissioner Shoneman?
Yes.
Commissioner Lemon?
Yes.
Commissioner Shea?
Yes.
Mayor Donches?
Yes. All right. And now we have another motion from Commissioner Moriarty.
I move by roll call that the board go into non-public session pursuant RSA 91A3, Roman numeral 2A, to consider the compensation as to city employees.
And that's roll call, right?
Yes.
You call the roll call?
Yes, absolutely. Commissioner Moriarty?
Yes.
Commissioner Shoneman?
Yes.
Commissioner Lemon?
Yes.
Commissioner Shea?
Yes.
Mayor Donches?
Yes. So we will again go into non-public session. For the Then we move to seal the minutes.
Okay, now we're okay. Yep, now we can.
All right, so we're back in public session. I think Commissioner Moriarty has a motion.
Yes, I move by roll call to seal the minutes of the Board of Public Works non-public meeting of February 24, 22, until such time as the majority of the board votes that the purpose of the confidentiality will no longer be served.
Could you call a roll, please?
Commissioner Moriarty?
Yes.
Commissioner Shoneman?
Yes.
Commissioner Lemon?
Yes.
Commissioner Shea?
Yes.
Mayor Donges?
Yes. Motion passes. Commissioner Moriarty?
Return to meeting, Mayor.
All right. You're the vice chair, you know what I mean?
Yes.
The honor goes to you. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes, and the meeting is adjourned at 6:35 p.m.